Welcome to Learning Lua. Today we're going to look at the OS library that is part of the Lua scripting language. Now the OS or operating system library has a lot of pre-built tools that are available to us to be able to quickly and easily get a lot of material back from the device. This, of course, if you're using an operating system piece of information, it is based upon whatever the current setting is inside the device that you're using this. We're going to take a look at a few of these that are more commonly used. Clock is very useful if you're wanting to know how long it takes for a particular set of code to execute. We've also got great time and date tools inside the OS library that work a little bit differently. We'll talk about that. We've also got quite a few other tools, as you can see, on the operating system library that can be very useful inside of our environment. To begin with, we're going to look at the clock and OS time. OS time's primary function is to convert any given date and time to seconds. So it's going to return the information in total seconds since January 1st of 1970. 1970 is the beginning point for that calculation. When it is called without arguments, the OS time will return in seconds the amount of time that has elapsed from January 1st, 1970 to the current date and time. So to begin with, I'm using OS clock, and you can see that it took 9/1000ths of a second for that one command to execute inside the system. So let's take a look at OS time. Here I have assigned the variable T1 to OS time, so it will return the information for the current date and time since 1970 in seconds. And there you have it, in case anybody was curious to know how much time has elapsed since January 1st of 1970. Now this is actually a very useful piece of information that can do all kinds of calculations with if we have a specific date and time. I've gone through and added a second one. If you pass OS time a table with the year, month, day, and optionally the hour, minutes, and seconds that you're wanting to measure, it will also generate that number of seconds from that time from 1970. So in this particular case, I've got January 1st of 1999, because we all want to party like it's 1999. And I went ahead and gave it an hour and minute and seconds as well, just for grins. This returns to us a very different number, as you can see, from comparing it to a date in 2016 to a date in 1999, we get very different. Now where this becomes very useful is if we want to see the difference in seconds that have elapsed between two times. So here I'm using OS diff time, and it returns and then passing it by two parameters, T1 and T2, and it gives the difference between the current date and time and 1999 in seconds. This can be converted back, of course, so that we can see exactly how many years, months, days, hours, minutes, and seconds have elapsed between two specific dates. Working in concert with OS time, we have OS date. Now, OS date converts from seconds back to a date and time. So it's basically the opposite of OS time. It returns a table when given an argument and a time number value. It can be a very useful tool. Let's see that in work with our T1 and T2. So let's first see what my current operating system date is. As you can see, it's returning Monday, July 11th, 2016 at 18:49:50. You could also have it give the time zone that is returning as well. That happens to be the date, time, and day of the week that I'm recording this particular video on. You can get additional information by passing it specific parameters. Here I'm passing it star T. The star T returns the full table for the date and time that has been stored, so I'm storing in it date 1, OS date, and we're passing it T2, which is my 1999 information, and then using the pairs tool, which we talked about in a previous tutorial, using pairs, which is also referred to sometimes as a generic for, we can go through and see all of the information that was passed. So here we have print OS date, which is my Monday, July 11th, and then passing it the T2 information, we get back the year, 1999, day, the seconds, the hours, the day of the year, which is Y day, the month, the minutes, and is daylight savings time turned on, which is false, the program right now, and the day of the week, which would have been the sixth day of the week, so Friday. So if anybody was curious to know when the first fell in 1999, now you know. You can also get what day of the week the information was stored. So here, passing it percent A returns the day of the week, Friday, for the value that we passed at T2. A few other parameters that can be very useful is checking the environment. So here's my OS environment, which returned, and I passed it home, which basically get environment variable is pulling up anything that is stored on the global variables table for your operating system, and there's a whole list of them. Here I've pulled up home, which is returning where files are being stored. Now the final command, which I do not recommend using, is OS exit. OS exit will cause problems, and if you're making an app with Corona SDK or any of the other tools that are out there, this is will get your app rejected by the app stores if you use OS exit. If you're making an app for desktop or another environment, OS exit does just what it sounds like. It exits the application and it has completed the debugging session. So that's a few of our operating system commands. Of course, we have quite a few others in there that are a little bit more advanced, but they are available to you inside your operating system. If you're using Lua inside of another tool set, such as Lumberyard or Corona or one of the others that are making heavy use of Lua nowadays, you do need to make sure that it is available to you inside the operating system. For mobile devices, usually the execute is not available to you, but that'll vary depending upon which mobile system which mobile software developer's kit you're working with. You need to check and see what your software developer's kit will allow you to use for your application development. We have a lot more tutorials and lessons forthcoming. If you'd like to follow what's happening, you can follow us on Twitter at Dr. Brian Burton, or Facebook at Burton's Media Group, or follow us on our website, burtonsmediagroup.com. If you'd like notification through YouTube, hit the like or subscribe button.